Good morning. Welcome to the parish community of St. Francis of Assisi. In the presence of the resurrected Christ, let us praise God, singing, "Hold us in your mercy." Please stand.
Good morning. We continue our celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Special welcome to all of you gathered here, those of you who are regular parishioners, those of you who come from far away. We are honored that you have chosen to be with us, to worship with us in this Lenten season. Today we have an image of Jesus at the temple, where he responds to the injustice and the wrongness of the people's behavior with a sense of anger and rage. We take a moment to recognize that at times we become sometimes complacent with some of the wrongdoings that are taking place within our community and within our world. We take a moment and we ask for God's mercy and for God's forgiveness and for a change of heart as we pray. Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd who goes after the lost sheep. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you are the light that helped the blind to see. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the word made flesh that helped the deaf to hear. Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on all of us. Forgive all of our sins and bring us all to everlasting life. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-loving God, You are the author of every mercy and all goodness. In our fasting and prayer and almsgiving, you have shown us a remedy for our own sin. We pray that you look graciously upon us, our confession of lowliness, as we grow in holiness and grace. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord, your Son and Redeemer, forever and ever.
Reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, God delivered all these commandments. I, the Lord, am your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery. You shall not have other gods beside me. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not leave unpunished the one who takes his name in vain. Remember to keep holy the Sabbath day, honor your father and your mother, that you may have a long life in a land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male or female slave, nor his ox or ass, nor anything else that belongs to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm response is number 784.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, Jews and Greek alike, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
My friends, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. As the Passover was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem in the temple precincts, and he came upon people engaged in selling oxen and sheep and doves, others seated changing coins. He made a kind of a whip of the cords, and he drove them all out of the temple area, sheep and oxen alike. He knocked over all of the money changers and their tables, spilling all their coins. He told those who were selling doves, "Get them out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace." His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house consumes me." At this, the Jews responded, "What sign can you show us authorizing that you can do these things?" "Destroy this temple," was Jesus' answer, "and in 3 days I will raise it up." They retorted, "This temple took 46 years to build, and you are going to raise it up in 3 days? Actually, he was talking about the temple of his body. Only after Jesus had been raised from the dead did the disciples recall what he had said, and came to believe the scripture and the word that he had spoken. While he was in Jerusalem during Passover feast, many believed in his name, for they could see the signs he was performing. For his part, Jesus would not trust himself to them because he knew them all. He needed no one to give him testimony about human nature. He was well aware of what was in man's heart." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, again, a special good morning to the community of St. Francis. It seems like it's been a while, probably too long. I begin by asking you to conjure up, what is your image of Jesus? How do you think of Jesus? A lot of us have a variety of different images that we rely on. We probably think of Jesus, again, with things that, you know, we grew up with, where Jesus is presented, you know, maybe that image of the divine mercy with the rays coming from Jesus's hand. We think of that image of Jesus pointing to his heart, the Sacred Heart. We think of Jesus with like a sheep over his shoulder, or we think of Jesus surrounded by children, beloved by everyone, a prophetic preacher, a magnet who drew all sorts of people to him because he was such a healer and such a prophetic speaker and someone who helped to give them meaning and purpose. And yet with all of those images that we have of Jesus, I would doubt and I would question that probably no one has an image of Jesus like the image that we hear today. This is found in all four Gospels, but it's often referred to as the cleansing of the temple. It is an angry Jesus. It's not a loving Jesus, it's not a compassionate Jesus or a healing Jesus, it's an angry Jesus. And it's always important to kind of understand what made Jesus so angry. Having a bad hair day, or was there a little bit more to it? Well, I think we come to see when we scratch beneath the surface, probably there was a lot more going on than meets the eye. Here it is, of course, it's the Passover. People, the Jewish people, are coming from all over. It is a very special and holy time, a time when they hope to encounter God at the temple. And so they're going to have to make this exchange for a shekel, which was a currency for the Jewish people. And again, they're coming from different places, so there's a variety of different currencies. And so the money changers have to be attuned to that, so that the people can make their offering. And for some who are so poor they don't have any money, they have to bring different kinds of animals, because that's all they have. And yet in this exchange, it's valid, it's customary, but just the same, what's problematic and what Jesus observed from the sidelines is that these money changers are cheating them. They are being dishonest. They are not being candid, but they are rather manipulating their position and are doing what they have to do in a way that is wrong, it is unjust, and it is malintent. And it was something that really got him so outraged, because here you have these people seeking to encounter God, to give praise to God at this holy time, and they are being manipulated and mistreated. So Jesus just completely loses it and cries out, like we just heard, you know, why are you turning my father's house into a marketplace? Commonly referred to as the cleansing of the temple. But Jesus' motivation was right. And we recognize that this image here of Jesus being just perplexed and so bothered by the injustice of what's happening before his very eyes is something that he can't quietly just ignore as if it's okay. It's a different image of Jesus, but something that we probably need to think about a little bit, especially in terms of we who claim to be followers of Jesus. Last night I had the privilege of watching Lincoln. Great movie, and I'd highly recommend it. But it's fascinating just to watch as Lincoln and his fellow lawmakers, and Democrats, Republicans, are debating the whole issue about the abolition of slavery. And certain people are standing up, making their cause like, well, if we stop slavery, then what's going to happen? Looking into the future, well, then they're going to own land. These people are going to want to vote. They're going to marry our daughters. And then the debate continues back and forth. And Lincoln gets so angry and so annoyed with some of the positions that are coming forward, he cries out, "You can't own people." And there's a silence. And it's very telling. Because again, he's calling attention to the wrongness of owning people. The idea that they are not like objects, but they are people. They are made in the image and likeness of God. And that is unjust. That is not right. And of course, his anger is motivated by this horrible injustice. We could probably count many, many instances where we saw and recognized various people and groups of people who have kind of stood up for what was not right. We look at the current status in the church right now. A time that's easy to say, we're in a kind of a crisis mode, if you will. It's a challenging time. It's not the church in many instances that we grew up with. And of course, the abuse and a lot of the challenges that have taken place within various leaders and what have you, not just locally, but throughout the world, has caused, again, a lot of people to come forward to talk about these injustices, the wrongdoing, the abuse, the manipulation of various things that were not right. It had to end. It had to be brought to a completion. It's been the cleansing of the church, if you will, and I think it will continue. It's hard. It's not easy. We can probably think of other circumstances within our own lives that became very messy, very complicated, very unclean, if you will, and certain things had to kind of be brought to the forefront. You can think of certain marriages where, you know, life was just very challenging, very, very difficult. Spouses were not on the same page. There was the elephant in the living room. Everybody was ignoring, and things were just going on. Same old, same old. And then certain things had to kind of come to fruition, and somebody just called forward and said, this can't continue. This is not right. This is unjust. In some instances, the divorce brought about a cleansing, if you will, a new beginning, something that was long overdue. I can't help but to think of a parish school that we had long, long time ago, the parish where I worked. We had a principal who had probably been there for about 25 years. She was a great educator, but she ran a very, very tight ship. But come to find out, for many of the teachers who had been there for so long, she was pretty, not only was she oppressive, but she was tough. And some of the things that she did were not right. And they came forward. They came to the pastor. They voiced their concerns. They voiced the problems and challenges that they had. They stayed at the school, though, because they liked it so much and they loved it and it was so important to them. But long and short of it, it couldn't continue. And eventually we had to let her go. And they hired a friar to serve as the interim principal. And at that first faculty meeting, he opened up and said, well, I just invite any of you to share your thoughts, your feelings about what's transpired these last couple of months. And there was a silence. And he looked out to the blank stares of the teachers. And there was just this paralyzing silence. And it was almost like he was perplexed. And one of the teachers raised her hand and said, in the last 25 years, we have never, ever been asked what we think or to share our feelings or thoughts. Again, it's amazing what certain people can live with for a long period of time, and then suddenly something happens and it brings about a cleansing, a time of change. Sometimes we recognize and we step back and say, you know what? I never get angry. I don't know that that's always a good thing. Sometimes when we don't get angry, we maybe become very, sometimes complacent. And we can look around and there's things going on that aren't right, that are kind of unjust. Certain people are being hurt, but, you know, we can kind of adopt the attitude, that's not really my business. But today, Jesus is providing us with a different image. He is motivated by what is not right and what is not just. And for us, maybe we need to reconsider or revise our own image of Jesus and to recognize and look around some of the things that we struggle with, certain things that we know are not right, that don't feel really connected in the way they should, to ask for Jesus to guide us, that we may respond in a way that brings about a certain cleaning and a certain renewal, not just for ourselves, but for all people who are involved. May God's peace and all that is good be with you. Together we stand, and in one voice and one heart, we profess our creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. We now bring our own prayers, our needs, and our hopes before the Lord. Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
That the cross of Jesus, who emptied himself in death, may be the foundation, measure, and a critique of our words and actions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That armed conflict upon the earth may cease, for the triumph of peace, which is the work of justice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the care and healing of the earth, our mother, may reflect God's healing grace for our souls. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the griefs, sufferings, and wounds of our world may complete what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, the church. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That a deepening of faith for all who believe may be marked by a vitality of witnessing to the power of the cross. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may hunger for eternal life, the hope of all who mourn and are dead in Christ, including Julia Ashkar. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the people and situations we hold deep within our hearts may be received at this holy table. Let's pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Gracious and loving God, we ask that you continue to pour forth your Spirit upon all of us gathered here. Dispel the darkness of our hearts and of our world. Grant that we may always have a correct faith and a certain hope and a perfect charity as we seek to carry out your holy and true command. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As we prepare the Lord's table and ourselves to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, let us join in singing hymn number 442. O God, you search me. Number 442.
Pray, my friends, that this, our sacrifice, will be acceptable to our good and loving God. Good and gracious God, in this holy season of Lent and on this holy day, We ask that you accept the special gifts that we bring to your table, the gifts of bread and wine and the gifts of our lives. May they always be acceptable and pleasing to you. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. My friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, almighty and ever-loving God, and through your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. For by your gracious gift each year, your faithful await the sacred Easter feast, with the joy of mind made pure, so that more eagerly intent on prayer and works of charity, and participating in the mysteries by which we are reborn, that we may be led to the fullness of your grace and bestow on your sons and daughters all that is good. And so now, with all the angels and all the saints and all the powers of heaven, we sing together the hymn of your glory, and with that end, together we acclaim. O Lord, you are holy indeed, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending forth your Spirit upon them, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread into his sacred hands. He blessed it and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper had ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. We pour it forth for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. We give you thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, and all your holy people your Son has gained for you. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on all of us, we pray, that together with Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles, the martyrs, Saint Francis of Assisi, and all the saints on whose constant intercession we rely for help, may we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. for it is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in union with the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Now we stand and together in one voice and one heart, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance to your will, for you live and reign forever and ever. My friends, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you. Let us now share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Thank you very much. God, you take away the sins of my friends, behold, behold the Lamb of God. Behold the one who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-loving God, may this holy sacrament that we have received fill the inner depths of our heart with a sense of joy, and that we may grow in understanding what we may do with our gifts and talents to be partakers with bringing about your kingdom here on earth. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. I don't think there's any announcements, so that's always a good thing. But just be attuned to the bulletin and just attuned to the schedule for Holy Week and Easter, and share that with family and loved ones. My friends, the Lord be with you. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. May the blessings of Almighty God come upon all of us gathered here in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, our celebration has ended, but our lives continue. Let us go in peace to love God and to serve each other. Have a great rest of the day, a wonderful week ahead. Stay safe, and we'll see you next week.
Let us go forth singing hymn number 464, I Heard the Voice of Jesus, number 464.
I think they were wondering where you were. Hello. Hello. How you doing? All right, you're welcome. Okay, God bless. Have a good one yourself. All right, we'll see ya. God bless. All right, have a good one. Bye-bye. We'll see ya. Have a good one. Good. See you later. Bye-bye. Have a good one. Things are not right. All right, okay, how you doing?
Good.
Good, how are you doing?
How are you?
Good, good, good. How's it going? Oh, okay. All right, great, 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 great. Yeah, we'll I'll get in touch and we'll fill out all the paperwork. Go through the Okay. Okay, yeah, we'll do the 20th. I have it, yeah. On a Saturday.
Yeah.
Okay. And that will be up here or down to the south end. Okay. All right. Yeah, this will be good. Okay. Yeah, I'll be in touch with them. Glad you came up to me. Okay. All right. Okay, good. All right. Congratulations. All right. Okay. All right. Bye-bye. Hello. How are you?
Not so good.
No? No, things are not so good. What's going on? Okay. In terms of payment? You ended up paying for it. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Well, so they gave you something to show their gratitude. I won't worry about it.
I was supposed to share with her.
Well, no, but I don't think I'd beat yourself up.